continue in the store with me, but what you won't see people running around screaming, call 911. Do something, do something. So watch what takes place here in verse 10. But Paul went down. He went down three flights of stairs. Now remember, they didn't have elevators down there. So the guy's moving. He's going down the stairways. And so he says, he goes down. He fell on him and he braced him. And he said, now picture this. He goes down. He picks old Lucky up. He puts him in his arms. He's holding him. And he says to them, do not trouble yourself, for his life is in him. Quit worrying. His life is in him. Now, listen real close to what really took place here. Paul is used by the Holy Spirit in the manifestations or the demonstrations of two things: the gifts of healing or the working of miracles. Biblically, that is 1 Corinthians 12, verse 9 and verse 10. And you will see those words, the gifts of healing or the working of miracles. Those are all by the Holy Spirit. Now, I can't find anywhere in the Bible it says those have stopped. So a week ago, Tuesday, which would have been October 1st, we were here on a Tuesday night prayer, and there's roughly 20 of us. And man, the Holy Spirit just came in, and there was a birthing with all of us. We just got into agreement, and we said, we believe the month of October is going to be a month of healing and a month of miracles. And we begin to see some things take place. Last night, some things were released. You saw some things that were released in our worship. I believe our God is the healer. His covenant name is Rapha, which is Psalms 103:3, the God who heals. He's the God of miracles. So what would happen tonight if I just gave an invitation right now and said, is there anybody in here needs to be touched with healing or need a miracle? How many of you would just boldly stand up? Go ahead. Go ahead. Just boldly stand up. We might as well just act on the word of God. Let's just obey the scriptures. So we see people standing all around us, need healings, miracles. But what's happened more and more, we don't give the Holy Spirit the opportunity to do what he wants to do. And so you can see people all around you. If you feel comfortable, you can get out of your chair. You can go lay hands on them. That's biblical. We're called to lay hands on people, okay? And so if you desire to do that, go ahead. If you're standing or on you're the stream and you're sitting and you need to be standing, get your blessed assurance up too, because we want to pray for you too. Now, stretch our hands out here, guys. Let's just pray right now in the name. Father God, you see men, women, young, old, and in between all over this house. And Father God, you said by the power of the Holy Spirit that there would be gifts of healing and working of miracles. So right now, in the name of Jesus, we loose your miracle power. We loose your healing into bodies. Father God, miracles into circumstances. And Lord, we pray your blessing right now. We release the power of the Holy Spirit in Jesus' name. Holy Spirit, we invite you to do what you were sent to do. And right now, we give you glory. We give you honor in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Now, the only thing I ask you to do, when you realize there's a healing in your body or a miracle, I want to know, okay? We really need people to testify to let people know this is what God's doing. This is what God's doing. I'm just telling you right now, this is going to happen the whole month of October, and we're seeing things already. I thought, wow, this is interesting. I'm on Acts 20, verse 10, and here a week ago, we start praying, Lord, birth right here, birth. And so, man, God's good. God's good. So, old Lucky went from lucky to unlucky, and he's back to lucky. It sounds like God, doesn't it? Verse 11. Now, when he had came back up, that's Paul. This guy's amazing. He's preaching the word. The guy falls out of the window and dies. He runs three floors down, lays hands on him, raises him from the dead by the power of the Holy Spirit. He runs back upstairs. Here he is. He's back on. And it says, now when he had come back up, he broke bread and he ate. Now most believe this time they'd already partaken of the communion elements. They were having a little midnight snack. Why did they need a midnight snack? Keep reading. Because Paul talked a long while, even till daybreak, and then he departed. So he goes back upstairs, and then he picks up back where he's off, and he speaks till dawn. Now let me ask you a question. What time's dawn at? Six? Time change can be seven? So this dude, we know he's probably preached from midnight till at least six. How many of us get upset if we go past an hour? Some of you said, Pastor, don't get no ideas. But you look and you think, well, they wanted to hear the things of God. Paul, he's up all night. He's raising folk from the dead. He's preaching the word of God. And then he's got to catch a ship. So he runs and he departs. And look at verse 12. So they brought the young man in alive. Here's old Lucky. And they were not a little comforted. I bet not. I'm sure when he falls out the window, the majority of them, they don't go down the stairs. They're not in shape to go down the stairs. And so they're all looking down the window. And now it says they're not a little comforted. Man, they're overcome with joy. They're like, wow, he's still here. God's so good. God is so good. So he goes to a couple different cities, and I'm having to move for time's sake. Pick back up with me in verse 16. For Paul had decided to sail past Ephesus so that he would not have to spend time in Asia, for he was hurrying to be at Jerusalem, if possible on the day of Pentecost. And so the day of Pentecost, it was the greatest feast of all in Israel. They wouldn't miss that feast. You know, when I was in Israel a number of years ago, I would ask my guide questions, and I've told you the guys, he would look at me like, what type of stupid are you? Why do you ask those questions? And so I asked him, I said, hey, you guys still observe the feast? And I'll never forget, he turned around and looked at me like, well, of course we do. Those things have been around forever. And so Paul's like, I got to get to Jerusalem, verse 17. So from Miletus, he sent to Ephesus, and he called for the elders of the church. Now, the word elder means a guardian, a shepherd, or an overseer. And notice he said, the elders of the church. Do you know the church is a big deal to the Lord Jesus? Matthew 16, 18, the Lord Jesus said, and I'll build my church, and the gates of hell won't prevail against it. And so can I tell you, Jesus is still building his church. The church is a big deal to him. And so when they had come to him, he said to them, he said to all these elders, he said, you know from the first day that I came to Asia in what manner I always lived among you. He said, you know how I lived and you know how I conducted my life. Now watch what he says here. I serve the Lord. I serve the Lord. You know, the Lord Jesus said in Matthew 20, 28, he said, I didn't come to be served, but to serve. It's interesting to me, Paul said, I serve the Lord. He didn't say, I was an apostle. I'm the man of God. I'm the man of the hour with power. He said, I serve God. And look how he said he served God. I serve God with humility, with a humble attitude, with unselfish concern for the welfare of others, the absence or the total absence of arrogance or conceit. Now, let me give you a little insight on that word humility. In 1 Peter 5, 5, Peter said this to the unction of the Holy Spirit. He said, God gives grace to the humble, but he resists the proud. God loves people that are humble. And you know what a humble person is? He's a servant that gives God all the glory. Father God, everything I do is because of you. So he said, I was a humble servant. And he said, I serve the Lord with humility and with many tears. With many tears. Ooh, he had some pain. And trials, which happened to be, or to me, by the plotting of the Jews. And so what Paul shares here is he said, I serve God with humility, but I had tears, I had trials, I had sorrow, I had afflictions. And I believe he tells us these things, that if you're a real servant of God, you might as well get ready. Because there's going to be seasons of tears in your life. Sometimes the tears are tears of pain, but sometimes they're tears of joy. Some of you in here, do you just weep before the Lord at times? And I weep a lot. I cry, and I got where I don't even try to hide it anymore. I just go with the flow. Just go with the flow. I'm like, but I believe this is a warning. Again, there's going to be tears, and there's going to be times of trials. Keep reading, verse 20. Ooh, this gets good. Paul said, how I kept back nothing that was helpful, beneficial, or profitable, but I proclaimed it to you. Now look what he says, how his proclamation was, and I taught you publicly from house to house. And so he says, I never shrank back. I didn't stop. I didn't give up. I spoke to you whether it was publicly or in your house. And so Paul is the guy who in Romans 1 said, I'm not ashamed of the gospel. I'm not ashamed to tell people I'm a Christian. Are you one of those undercover Christians? So that means at work, if the people looked around you and they said, you're a Christian? They're shocked that you're a Christian because you never act that way. And so notice what he said. He said, I never shunned, I never backed off from telling you the truth. Now, I'm going to end Acts right here. I want you to go to 2 Timothy chapter 4 with me. 2 Timothy chapter 4, and this is what we'll end with. And then you'll have to come back next week. And we'll pick back up. I'm going to speak a couple weeks on Acts here. And I am excited about speaking. I really like to speak on this. Acts 2, verse 4. Acts 4, verse 2. I'm sorry. I speak for a living. I'm sorry. Look what he says here. Now, he's talking to this pastor named Timothy. And he said, Timothy, preach the word. Preach the word. Do you know there's times in my life I hear the Lord say that? Preach the word. Preach the word. Don't try to entertain them. Don't try to be funny. Don't try to please man. Preach the word. Just that's it. That's your assignment. Preach the word. And then he says to him, you got to be ready in season and out of season. Your job is to convince people through the scriptures. Your job is to rebuke them. Now what you find out a lot of times when you rebuke people, they hit the road, Jack, and they never come back. Rebuke and exhort, encourage with all longsuffering and teaching. Now why is this so big? Now read real closely here with me in verse 3. For the time will come when they, the people of the church, will not endure sound doctrine. But according to their own desires. In other words, we don't want the full truth of the Word of God. We just want you to tell us what we want to hear. Their desires. Now, he says this time is going to come. Can I tell you? It's here. It's here. And he goes on to say, their own desires, because they have itching ears, they will heap up for themselves teachers, a conflict with the precepts of the Bible. They have itching ears. They close their ears to the truth, and it's this thing. Don't talk to me about sin. I'm okay with you talking to me about love. But don't talk to me about the controversial things of the Bible. Well, the whole Bible's controversial. And so he says there's coming a time where people are going to want you to compromise it. He goes on to say in verse 4, and they will turn their ears away from the truth, the word of God, and they will be turned aside to fables. Man-made beliefs, the philosophies, the ideas of men. And so what happens with men is we begin to water down the Bible. We begin to change the Bible, but God's really clear. He says, don't add to the word or don't take away from the word, because the word of God doesn't need your help. And so this becomes a strong warning right now. So with me saying this, remember Paul said, I didn't shun from going back from telling you the truth. I told you the truth, even it wasn't easy. Verse 5. But you be watchful in all things. Endure afflictions. Do the work of an evangelist. And fulfill your ministry. And so when you begin to see what he's talking about, he tells Timothy, you got to anchor yourself to the word of God. And then you got to preach the word of God. I don't know where you're at on this level, but let me ask you a question right now, and this will help every one of us in here. How do you view the word of God? You say, well, I can take it or I can leave it. You know, I think the Bible is about 50% true and 50% wrong. See, I got to get to a place in my life where I base my entire life off of this every day. 24/7. So you know what I'm asking you? Fall in love with the Bible. If you've never fallen in love, fall in love with the Bible, because this is God's heart, his word to me and you. And it's interesting, way back in the book of Acts, that Paul was dealing with this, and he had to tell him, I didn't shun from teaching the truth. And so he's telling Peter this. Peter, preach the word, preach the word, preach the word. So I'm just telling you right now, if you're going to come here, you're going to hear the word of God, okay? That's all I know. That's all I know. And I'm not going to apologize for it. You know, you remember the old movie with Jack Nicholson and Tom Cruise, and Jack Nicholson or Tom Cruise said, I want the truth. And Jack looked at him and said, you can't handle the truth. Come on, stand up here. I'm going to get you out of here. So you got to come back. We'll pick back up in this. Golly, I didn't get very far. Goodness of God. That's okay. That's okay. Come on, raise your hands here to heaven. Father God, soak us tonight. Holy Spirit, go to work in each one of us. But Father God, I pray your blessing right now. We're servants. We're servants of yours, Father God. Lord, dip us with the robe of humility right now. Put a humility in our hearts. And Father God, I pray right now, if any of that are facing tears, afflictions, and trials, grace. Just your grace upon them. Lord, breathe upon them right now. And Father God, as we get ready to go, grace us to value your word. Grace us to live by your word. Grace us to appreciate your word. And Father God, as we get ready to head out of here, we thank you for your word tonight, but Lord, we also thank you for the Holy Spirit, the healings and the miracles that are going on right now in our midst. Lord, we ask that you order our steps the rest of this week in Jesus' name. Come on, let's clap to the Lord here. Goodness of God. Goodness of God. Well, I'm going to dismiss you. I'm glad you came out of Sunday night. If you need prayer, we're going to be down here. If you got questions, you got thoughts for me, I welcome them. Other than that, have a good week. Keep praying. Father.